Good morning, everybody. Welcome to our Facebook church. I want to make a massive welcome to everybody who would never set foot in a church. To any of you who have been put out of churches, went to church and made to feel uncomfortable. To anybody who also has went to church and made to feel great. I want to just welcome you all. But I want to ask you a question today. Are you black or are you white? This morning, do you feel clean or do you feel dirty? Do you feel like you've got a heavy burden hanging over you, or do you feel light? Because I want to welcome you into our rainbow of colours. We believe that everybody is different. Everyone's an individual and we all experience life differently. But God so loved the world with all its cultures, individuals, customs, traditions, beliefs, that he gave his only son. Jesus came as a direct representation of the Father with the Logos, the communication from the Father, to show what the Father was like. And he came so that none should perish, that none should be perforated, that no one should become useless, that no one should have no hope, but all should receive everlasting life. John 10:10 says that he came that we may have life and life in all its fullness, but in the original language, the word used there is the life of God. Zoe life, the life of God. He came so that we may have the life of God. In the beginning, it says in the book of Genesis, the story of Adam and Eve, it says that God made Adam and he walked with Adam and Eve in the garden and talked with Adam and Eve in the garden. And that's how God wanted it to be, us and the life of God with us every single day. He wanted us to listen to him because of the love relationship. So he gave us a choice. Here is a tree that you can eat from and a thing that you can do that will give you the knowledge of good and evil so that you choose for yourself what you think is good and what you think is evil. Or here is the tree of life and you can choose to live the life with me and lean on me because I know more than you and I can see more than you. I'm God and you're human. Of course, we know the story that we chose to decide for ourselves. Why shouldn't we decide for ourselves? We should be allowed to decide for ourselves. But in that decision, we forgot one thing, that we only see in part, that we don't see everything and that we never can. I can't see the intentions of someone else's heart. I can't see what's going on, even in the next room. I don't know everything. God wanted us to make choices already having discussed them with him because he sees everything. Not that we can't make our own choices, but that we can make them based on the knowledge that he has given us, because he is knowledge and he is wisdom and he is all in all, as the Bible says. There are many of us who a large majority of the church would not accept. There are many of us who feel not good enough for church, not worthy of God. And there are many of us who can't bear to even imagine God could exist because we think we might be believing in a fairy tale and wasting our life. We don't want to look ridiculous or be ridiculous. But today I want to ask you to give me a few moments, just a few moments, to pass on to you what I believe and feel very deeply God has given for me to say. Now, you don't have to believe in God. That makes no difference to me. And I totally respect everybody who has different beliefs and different knowledge than me. I say I know him and have experienced him, not that I believe in him, because to me, you can believe in the tooth fairy or Peppa Pig. It doesn't make them real. I was brought up in a home that was a Christian home. My father and mother ran the Come Back to God campaign with other people who I've been very grateful for my whole life. But it didn't make me know God. I could believe in God and I could believe in all of the religious rules that I got from these people who worshipped God and all the things that they said God told them to do and not to do and how they should be and how they shouldn't be and all the people we would accept and all the people we wouldn't. It didn't make me know God. It gave me a belief and a religion and a way that I was told I must live my life. And as a young child, you can often think that means I have to live my life this way or God is not happy with me and I can lose my salvation. As I grew up, I began to know God and I realized God is not like that. He doesn't give hard and fast rules that we must attain to. He wants us to actually just live in communication with him. He wants us, as I've said, to come to the decisions in life and face them with him. When Adam needed companionship in the Garden of Eden, God brought all the animals in front of him and allowed him to name them, and probably asked him every time, "Is this one suitable?" Every time Adam said no. And then God said, "Okay, I need to do a deeper work then, Adam. I need to bring something out of you that will be your companion. Something out of you that's going to fulfill you." And he put Adam to sleep willingly and created Eve. When Adam wakes up, he says, "Here you go, name her." Adam says, "I'm going to call her woman, for she's bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. She comes from me, and she's exactly right for me." But God did it willingly with Adam and allowed Adam to choose and allowed Adam to name. And to name in the Bible is to give authority, to have authority. God does not want to overtake your life and make you a religious maniac, but he does want to be part of it. And he wants you to cry out today and say, "God, if you're there, come and show me." Pastor Rachel from the Come Back to God campaign preached about 5 months ago. She preached on John chapter 8 and 9, which is about a blind man who was believed to be cursed from birth. Jesus heals this man. He puts mud on his eyes and sends him to wash in a stream. Rachel said, "As he passed by all the other people in the village, do you think they mocked him with mud on his eyes? Do you think they jeered at him?" And I sat there and thought, yeah, they probably did. Then she said, "When did his healing start?" And we all put our hands up and said, "When he was in the river, when he was walking, when he did what Jesus said." She said, "No. It was when he believed that he wasn't cursed, because the Son of God had come and met with him." Jesus was a rabbi, but he took the time, and rabbi means teacher, but he took the time to speak to this man who everyone else said was cursed. We can have so many curses said over our lives, can't we? People can say things, "You'll never amount to much, you're always going to be unhealthy," or "You're stupid, you are," whatever it might be. And we believe them. Perhaps we're the product of rape. Perhaps our mum and dad have split up. Maybe we think, "What was I born for? I have no purpose, I'm a mistake." Jesus says today, "No, you're not. No, you're not cursed from birth. No one is." Where the church have told certain people that they're cursed from birth, or they're cursed because of their relationships or because of their actions, God is saying, "No, you're not. No, you're my child." What happens with this blind man is that he goes into the temple after he's healed. And the Pharisees, who are the religious people of the day, come and they say, "Who healed you? Because it's a Sabbath, it's a Sunday, and you shouldn't be healed." Even his mum and dad sort of deny him because they don't want to get involved in this. And he says, "I don't know if this man is the Messiah, but I know he made me well." He makes no massive claim to Jesus being who Jesus was. He just says, "I know what he's done for me." And I'm not asking anybody today to make a massive claim, "I believe in God, I believe in Jesus, I'm going to be a Christian." But I'm asking you to give him a chance to do for you what you need him to do, so that you too can say, "I don't know, but I know he made me well." That's all Jesus wants. He doesn't want you to be religious, traditional. He doesn't want you to be acceptable to other people, because you are acceptable to him. The Bible is full of stories where Jesus goes to find the outcast. And this man, this blind man, gets put out of the temple because the Pharisees, the religious people, say, "You're cursed and you're trying to teach us." So they chuck him out. But the most beautiful verse in that chapter for me is one that God gave me when I had been ridiculed and put out and told off and made to feel so worthless and so small and so wrong and so evil in comparison to what the church expected and wanted, and I couldn't change who I was. This verse says, Jesus heard that the man had been put out and he came and found him. Jesus asked the man, "Do you believe in me?" Because that's all that Jesus cares about. Jesus cares where you are. And if you let him, he will come and find you. He knows you've been hurt, and he knows you've been put out, and he knows you've been betrayed, and he knows you've been made to feel small, and he knows all of the curses that have been put on your life. But he says, "I want to find you, and all I want to know is, will you give me a chance? Will you let me make you well? Not religion, not other people, just me." There's a story in the Bible of a lost sheep. And the sheep wanders off and it gets lost, and the good shepherd goes and he looks for the sheep and he hears the sheep calling. The sheep's caught in a bush and he lifts the sheep up and he untangles the sheep and he puts the sheep on his shoulder and he takes it home. He has a massive party. That's my God. Where you're tangled, he wants to untangle you, but he's waiting, because every decision, as I've said, is to be made by you. Every decision is to be made by you. You have authority over your own life and he's never going to take it away. But he wants to make those decisions with you and he wants to come and untangle you. The lost son went out, took his father's money, half of the inheritance he should have from his father's farm, and went to a foreign country, wasted the whole lot, and ended up working for a pig farmer, eating pig's food because he didn't have enough money for real food. And he sat there and said, my father's servants have food and I don't, I'm going to go home. So he goes home and the father's waiting at the gate and the father runs to him, kisses and hugs him, gives him the best ring, the best robe, the fatted calf, and they have a massive party. Later on, the older son, his brother, is angry and says, Dad, you never gave me anything. And the dad says, my son was lost and he's alive again. He was dead and he's found. Come, party with us. The older son is like the religious people who look at people who they don't think God should accept, and yet God is blessing them and giving them things and helping them and healing them and looking after them and being with them. And they get angry and they say, that's not fair, you've never done that for me. But then the father says, my son, you've always been with me and everything I have is yours. Perhaps we are the religious people who don't believe other people should be accepted. Perhaps we believe we should do these things and we should be a certain way to be accepted by God. And he says to you today, you've always been with me. Everything I have is yours. But to everybody, God says, everything he has is ours. Zoe life, the life of God. He wants us to live our lives with him. If you're dirty today, if you're black today, the Bible says, come, let us reason together. Though your sin is as scarlet, it will be white as snow. But the verse before that talks about stop oppressing people. Stop stealing from people. Stop harming people. Return to me and I will return to you. That's what the Bible says. Draw near to me and I will draw near to you. But we do that by changing our lives to be the way God wants it to be. And here you're going to think is the catch. I don't mean changing our lives to be religious. Not at all. I mean changing our hearts to be honest. I mean saying to God, I lived as if I didn't need you and now I do. There's a little man in the Bible called Zacchaeus. He couldn't see over the crowds, and I often can't see over the crowds because I'm short, so I recognise with him. So he climbs into this tree because apparently Jesus was coming and he was a renowned teacher at that time. He's in this tree and Jesus looks up and says, Zacchaeus, I want to come to your house for tea. But what I haven't said about this man is that he was a tax collector and worked for the Romans. The Romans were controlling the Jewish people. The Jewish people hated them. Zacchaeus worked for them and took people's money to give to them. But more than that, he took extra. He raised the prices and pocketed a lot for himself. He was a thief and he was denying his own people. Perhaps you've denied your own family. Perhaps you've betrayed your family. Jesus looks at you and says, I want to come to your house. I want to eat with you and I want to live with you and I want to be with you. Zacchaeus hadn't changed at this point, but then he changed. Because like with the blind man, the outcast, the blind man was outcast because he was born blind. Zacchaeus was outcast because he made a decision to hurt his family. But Jesus said, I want to be with you. Both men changed. The blind man saw and Zacchaeus saw in another way and gave away everything he'd stolen. In fact, he gave away double because he didn't need to steal anymore. He was accepted. He didn't need to struggle to be accepted and to get what he wanted because he knew that God loved him, accepted him, and looked after him. There's a woman who sat at a well, and it said that she went there when no one else did because she was an outcast. Jesus comes and sits with her and asks for her husband to introduce her to Jesus, but she says, I have no husband. Jesus says, I know you've had five. And the man you're living with now is not your husband. What is so unusual about this is that in those days, that was so frowned upon. She could have actually been killed for living that life. We don't know if she was a prostitute. We don't know if she was just a woman looking for love. We don't know if she was a woman who was passed down through different men. Maybe her husband had died, because there was a rule that if your husband died, you went to the brother, to the brother, to the brother. We know she had no rights. She was a woman, and this is way, way back in those days. So it isn't that she chose to ditch men. Men had ditched her. She was broken. Perhaps she was used. She felt she had absolutely no rights. So Jesus says, I want to give you living water. He asks her for a drink and then says, but the water I want to give you is life. I want to give you life, Zoe life, the life of God. And that's what he is offering us today. All of us who feel dirty, all of us who are thirsty. Jesus said to this lady, you will never be thirsty again. There's a verse in the Bible that says, come all you who are thirsty, come to the waters and be refreshed. Come all you who are hungry, come to the table and be filled. It's a metaphorical table. It means basically what God wants to give you. When the little children came to see Jesus, the disciples said, go away, the teacher's too busy, because they were just kids. Jesus said, no, don't stop the kids coming to me, for such is the kingdom of heaven. In other words, Jesus had time for everyone. It doesn't matter who you are. The kingdom of heaven is based on the fact that we rely on God and we just want to know him and we just want to see him and we will just welcome him. So today I'm not asking you to change any belief. I'm not asking you to decide you're religious, nor even to go to church. Although maybe it's a good idea to go for 6 weeks and say, God, if you're there, I'm going to go for 6 weeks, meet with me, reveal yourself to me. But what I'm asking you to do is similar to what my own dad did. He used to tell this story, so I'm going to tell it for you now. When he came to know God, he walked into a church. He used to play the honky-tonk piano in the RAF, and he told the dirty jokes. He was not the kind of person that you would think was at all a Christian. But he went into this church because he felt he just wanted to go, and he sat down the front. There was only three other people in the church, and the minister talked about having a burden. And the minister said, God can lift your burden. Well, my dad had a burden, and it was breaking his heart. So he bowed his head and he said, God, if that's true, do that for me. That was it. That's all he said. But there and then God did it. He felt God, the life of God, come into his being and it changed his life. I want to challenge you today. Don't believe in God. But if you're lost, if you're tangled, if you're black, if you're dirty, let God give you back the colour that you were born to have as you, the individual. Let God break the curse over your life. Cry out today in your heart, in your innermost being, and just invite him, welcome him, not tradition, not religion, just Jesus, just the Holy Spirit, because he wants to come and have tea with you tonight. He wants to come and have every day with you and help you make those decisions so that you can hear him and all the things that you don't know and make decisions, not based on what you see, but based on what is true. God bless. Take care.
Solid ground, firm through the fiercest droughts and storms.